Hey, good morning, everybody. Happy Easter to you all. Need a small favor. There's a good chance that we might fill up most of our chairs today, and there's one easy way that you could help serve people this morning. It's really easy. If you scoot towards the middle and just leave the outside chairs for the ushers so they can find places for people to sit. They might be still checking in their kids in the back. That would help out quite a bit. Thank you, Dulcie. Just an easy way we can help serve each other. One other note. We normally have a drummer, but he got pretty sick today. So if everybody can clap on beat while we're playing, that would help us out a lot. Not Tom. He doesn't know how to do that. But it'd be great if you guys would help me out. Seriously, though, there will be drums. You'll hear them. We're just playing them from an iPad. So just pretend like it's a real person. Okay? Let's go ahead and stand up today and turn our attention towards the Lord.
Our God is alive. He is risen. Now we are walking in freedom. Nothing as strong as our Jesus. Our God is alive.
Forever done, only
tell him thank you for what he's done. You guys are welcome to have a seat. It's great to be here with you all. Oh, we have a drummer now. Must have been awkward. Filling in. So whether you've been coming for a long time or whether this is your first time, know that you are very welcome here. My name is Derek. I'm one of the ministers on staff. You should know that we take communion every single Sunday. If you didn't grab one on the way in, if you raise your hand, anybody? Hey, Ted, would you help me out? Would you go get some communion? Ted's going to just walk down the aisle, and if you raise your hand, he sees you. Eric might help him out, and we'll be taking that in a few minutes. Awesome. Well, today we have yet another opportunity to worship God with other believers. It's rare. It only happens once a week, 15, 20 minutes at that. And my hope is that you will use this time to not just sing, right? It's not about singing, but to turn your attention to the Lord, to focus on Him, and to give Him praise, for He alone's worthy of it, right? I'm not, you're not. He is the only one that's worthy of our praise. So we got a song now called You Are God Alone. Let's just have you stay seated for this first part, and then we'll bring you up. Let's turn our attention towards Him.
You are.
Jesus says in John 6, he says, whoever believes in him will be granted eternal life. And that he will resurrect them on the last day. And may that day come soon. Right? May that day come soon. Perhaps today. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets. To look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity.
There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. And holy, holy is the Lord.
And every prayer
to take communion now. So why don't you guys go ahead and have a seat. Oh, man. So remember, as we receive this bread and juice, we are proclaiming that we believe, right? Otherwise, why do it? We're proclaiming that we believe in Christ and his sacrifice on the cross. And we're saying that we believe in Jesus every time we do this, and that fills us with such hope, or it should anyway. Because we know the end of the story, right? We know that he has already won. We know that we will be with him one day forever. And so right now, let's take a moment and reflect on that. And I encourage you to use this time well. This is my favorite part of the service. I pray we're going to give you space to pray to him, to give him thanks with your own words. And any time during this next song, you're free to receive communion, okay? Let me pray for you. God, it's a privilege just to be able to pray to you, and that you would hear us is that's just an amazing thing. We thank you for that lifeline that we have. We're so humbled by the grace and the mercy that you've poured into our lives. I pray that we can reciprocate that to others in hopes that they would also come to believe in you and in your grace and in the cross. We worship you, God. We bow before you. We love you so much. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Morning. Did I startle some of you awake there on that? Hey, happy Easter. Wow. And whether this is your first time or your thousandth time at Fall Creek, we are so glad that you set aside time to come and join us this morning. I believe God has a great word for us, an encouraging word, a challenging word, as we wonder at one of the most wonderful stories ever told. And before we jump in, I'm just going to ask you to bow with me again for a word of prayer. Father, what an amazing opportunity. You brought us all here. That's pretty incredible. And you don't do anything by accident. And so I pray that the purpose and the reason in your heart and your mind finds expression and realization in our hearts and our minds. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I don't know about your family, but ours are getting ready. My family is getting ready for the big event. The big event. You know what I'm talking about, right? It's happening. It's going to happen. I have to hold on to something when I wear these, because I literally cannot see a thing. I tested it this week, looking at the sun, and it works. These are the ones that pass the test, right? There's some frauds out there, but these are the real ones. You're going to have to get one of these. And I was thinking about this, and you know, we're making plans. Where are we going to be? Where are we going to watch it? And I've heard rumors of people paying $200 for some parking space somewhere where it's really wide open. I'm thinking, really? It's just right up there. I don't know. Call me silly, right? I don't know. But I was sitting there, and I'm thinking, and I'm pondering about this event that's coming, and I just had to giggle a little bit because in my mind's eye, I'm seeing like millions of people doing this. Wow. There's the sun. Oh, here comes the moon. There goes the sun. Oh, there goes the moon. And there's the sun again. Thank you very much. That was awesome. Did you feel it? It's like, whoa, this is incredible. I moved even as we talk about it. I thought, wow, that's going to be a lot of fun. And I was thinking about that, and I was thinking about our story for today. Because you see, that event, this eclipse, is an invitation collectively for all of us to look up, isn't it? And what we find in our story today, spiritually speaking, it is an invitation to each and every one of us to collectively look up. Really remarkable. And I'll unpack a little bit more about what I mean here as we jump into the story. We're going to be in Luke chapter 24. We're going to start with these first 12 verses. At this point, Jesus has been in the grave those 3 days, and now it is Sunday morning, and this is what we read. But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them clothed in dazzling robes. And the women were terrified, and they bowed with their faces to the ground. And then the men asked them, "Why are you looking among the dead for somebody who is alive? He isn't here. He's risen from the dead. You remember what he told you back in Galilee? That the Son of Man," that's the name Jesus used for himself, "the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day." Then they remembered that he had said this. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. But the story sounded like nonsense to the men, so they didn't believe it. However, Peter jumped up and ran to the tomb to look. Stooping, he peered in, and he saw the empty linen wrappings. Then he went home again, wondering what had happened. It's interesting, isn't it? Here comes the women early in the morning to finish the burial process, only to find the tomb is empty. No Jesus, but a couple of angels there. Whoa, that was a little bit surprising. And they're told by the angels, "Hey, he's gone. You're looking among the dead for someone who's living." Well, that doesn't really make much sense, does it? And so they took off. And we find the response to their story from the very beginning is the same response that we see in our world today to the story of a man who walks out of his own grave. Same responses, right? What happened? Well, they came, but the story, the disciples, sounded like nonsense. The story sounded like nonsense to them. In most of our world, that's kind of their response. Not kind of, that is a response. This is silly. The story, yeah, some guy, you know, 2,000 years ago walked out of his own tomb. I don't know about all that. And it's just nonsense. And they just move on with life. And this is a very common, probably the most common reaction in our world. Crazy story. Then we find another reaction here, and this was Peter. He's listening to the story, And it may have struck him as nonsense at first, but he got up. He got up. He said, wait a minute. I think I kind of remember Jesus saying something about this. And he runs all the way down to the tomb. They all knew where the tomb was. They all watched when Jesus' body was brought down on Good Friday and put in the tomb. They all knew where it was. They ran right to it. He ran right to it, and he stooped down, and he looks inside, and he goes, oh, there's no Jesus in here. And all he saw was the wrappings that were on his body that were quickly put on there Friday night after his crucifixion. And he's looking, and it says that he went and he wondered what had happened. So as we sit here today, we may identify with some of these responses, right? We may be in a place in our world, in our life, where we're saying, you know what? Dead people don't come out of their graves. It's nonsense. Dead people are dead. That's kind of why we call them dead people. And so we go down to the grave, and I show you, and I look, and I go, there they all are. Nobody's coming out. Dead means dead. It's the end of it. It's just kind of a nonsensical story. Or maybe there's some, you know, some spiritual thing we can get out of it. But, you know, dead people don't come out of their graves. Maybe we're here today and we've been willing to take a step towards the wondering. Huh. Now, this has been around for a really long time, this story. Seems like crazy stories. They don't really carry this kind of staying power, this kind of impact in those who are embracing the story. Maybe I should do a little bit of wondering. That's fair. Maybe it's time to do a little bit of wondering, to ask, well, why is this story even being told, and what's the significance of it, and really, what's the testimony of the eyewitnesses? What's the testimony of history? What's the testimony? You know, we can go through and we can look at all the different things, but that takes a wanderer. It takes a wanderer. Someone who thinks it's just nonsense won't ever take the time to wonder, will they? Stupid. It's kind of like the moon's made of cheese. No, I'm not going to wonder about the moon being made out of cheese. Okay. Now, that's kind of the same vein that some people hear this story about Jesus walking out of his own grave. But the testimony of the Bible, the testimony of the angels that day, the testimony of the hundreds of eyewitnesses to this event, and the testimony of literally the billions of lives over the last 2,000 years who have been transformed by who they say was someone who walked out of his own grave, beg to give us a good reason to wonder. Maybe I need to think a little bit more about this first Easter morning. You see, the resurrection at its core is an invitation to look up. It's an invitation to take our eyes from the little temporary world, or everything we could see, feel, hear, and touch, and to consider that maybe there's something a little bit bigger than us. It's a wonderful question, and it's worth that consideration to ponder it through, to think it through. You know, we've heard countless people talk about these stories and where their bodies were physically dead and their soul was above their body, and they were seeing everything going on in the room. They were seeing things in other different places, in a hospital or wherever and whatever. And then when their body was resuscitated, they tell everybody, this is what I saw, and this is where you were wearing, this is where you were. And there was no way for any of these people to know any of those things unless they actually saw them. And this is being written by people who aren't really saying, I'm a Jesus follower, Bible believer. But the inescapable conclusion is that we are so much more than just the flesh and blood that we walk around in. And now we say maybe another reason to wonder. The resurrection is an invitation to look up. Now, we don't have to do that, of course. We could continue to look down. We could continue to stoop and look into the tombs or the graveyard of this old life to look among the dead for any signs of life. We could keep doing that. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, most people do. We're going to keep trying to find some signs of life in this little world that I walk around in and all of that, and on it goes. We need to understand something about that. And I think we already have probably come to this understanding, as a matter of fact, and that is the continuous decision to look down leads us to hopelessness. Absolute hopelessness. Because you see, all the usual suspects that are presented to us that will somehow give us meaning, give us purpose, give us answers to all the big questions of life, that will somehow satisfy this, you know, unstoppable curiosity in our souls and sense, there's more, and it's not that. Well, what are some of these suspects? When you look around in the world, one of the first ones that get held up is yourself. You are the reason why you should hope. It's in you. And I don't know about you, but I look in the mirror and I go, I don't really need to think there's a whole lot of reason just looking at myself. I'm kind of dumb. I don't know very much. And I'm not really terribly good looking or anything. I got nothing. It's just that's a dead end for me from the get-go. Well, then there's okay, well, another one, you're going to find hope in wealth and stuff and just gathering and accumulating. How many zeros? Man, the more zeros, man, that's gonna do it, right? Some of us in here have a lot of zeros. And we may be able to comment on, well, yeah, but you know what? None of those zeros tell me who I am or why I'm here or where I'm going. Or what happens when I take my last breath? Well, maybe it's a relationship. I just got to have this relationship, and boy, I'm going to have this great deal and this great family, and we're going to do all that, and then we find out that Mr. or Mrs. Wonderful isn't so wonderful, right? Feel sorry for my wife on a regular basis. And, you know, our kids, you know, they're great and everything, but, you know, people just like us, and it's like, Am I really going to find my meaning in all of that? Well, maybe it's just education. I just need to know a lot more stuff. I need to have all the philosophies. I need to be able to quote these guys and gals that are just really a lot smarter, and I need to watch enough TED Talks, and then I'm going to figure it all out. And, you know, and we come to our, you know, we're in a quiet moment, and there are very few of those. We're like, I think all these suspects are coming up short. Where do I find my hope? Is it going to be in the systems of people? Is government, is everything else going to somehow solve and provide this for me? You know, all of them are there, and we've had this opportunity to consider them for some length of time, and we find that the promised hope that these things have, they ultimately fail. And so we come back to verse 11 again, to those who are hearing this very first testimony about this dead guy who did actually walk out of his grave, as the testimony is from those who went that morning. And they said it sounded like nonsense. Well, maybe today, for you, you can take one step past, this is just nonsense, to at least wondering. Maybe I can wonder about this a little bit. Maybe I can ask some questions. Maybe I can sit down and talk to some people. Maybe I can do a little reading. Maybe I can hear the different voices over the centuries. Maybe I can wonder just a little bit. Perhaps if we're wondering today, maybe we come to this place where we say, you know what? The more I wonder, the more I see him. And it's my time to say, yes, I believe. Maybe if we're here today and we've already made that decision to trust Christ and we've seen the resurrected Jesus and we know him and we have a relationship and our lives are being transformed by him, what's a natural next step? It's to understand that he has called you to himself, not just for you, but for everybody around you. That you would be among the masses bearing witness to the reality that a risen Savior has changed your life. It's an amazing privilege and an amazing responsibility. And the hope that he has big plans for you. I don't know. What is your next step? Let me encourage you. I probably won't need to try to convince you of this, but hope. Hope is worth the pursuit. Don't just walk away from that story, even though it may begin to hit you as just nonsense. Well, there's another reason to consider and to think about this invitation, right? The resurrection is an invitation to look up, and that's because of this. The continuous decision to look down. The continuous decision to keep stooping and looking and being in the place of the dead, trying to see any signs of life. There's another reason to stop doing that and look up, because continuously doing that fills our heads and it fills our hearts with the voice of the grave. If all we're doing is looking in graves, trying to find if there are signs of a life, we will continue to hear the voice of the grave. And the voice of the grave is nothing like the voice of Jesus. And I was reading a devotion, and they put a little side-by-side on these two voices, and I just had to share that with you here this morning. They're very different, these words. The grave says, death will defeat you. Death will defeat you. No matter what you try to do, no matter all the little things and all the new technologies and everything, you know, you have a last day. You have an expiration date. Death says, I win. You will die. Jesus, he says, death doesn't get the final word. I do. The grave says, worry and stress about everything. Worry about everything. Worry about today. Worry about tomorrow. Worry about 10 years from now. Worry about then. Worry about this. Worry about the headline. Worry about this. Worry, 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 worry. Why? Because the grave says, I'm coming for you. I'm coming for you. Every step, every day. Right behind us, nipping at our heels. Jesus says, don't worry. Don't worry. I've got you. I've got you. The grave shouts so loud, all that matters is now. YOLO, right? You only live once. This is it. This is your chance. Soak it all up. Do whatever. Go wherever. Do this, do that. Just soak it all up like a vacuum cleaner. And at the end of the day, you open the vacuum cleaner and it's nothing but a hairy dust ball. Let me say, you know what? Maybe that wasn't such a good idea. No, that's not what Jesus says. Jesus says this, forever matters way more than now. Forever matters way more than now. The most important decision we're ever going to make in this life is where we are going to spend forever. It's the most important decision we're going to make. Everything else is just details. Am I going to be with God forever? Am I going to be separated from God forever? This is the most important decision any of us are ever going to make. Forever matters way more than now. And it's an interesting thing that happens when we embrace what Jesus said about forever being more important, and we have our attentiveness there, that now, that the now begins to take meaning because it's connected to the forever, you see. And now begins to make sense because forever is in view. Until then, we're just kind of stumbling around. The grave says, darkness will last forever. You're in that casket, slam the door down, and dig a hole, stick you in there, and it's just like, darkness forever. And the reality, as the Bible reveals it, it'd be far worse than if that happened to you. Now, Jesus said, my light overcomes the darkness. I step into a room and darkness flees. I step into a heart and darkness flees. That's what he says. The grave continues to speak. If we have our attention looking down, we'll hear a lot more. And here's another one. The grave says, game over. You lose. Jesus says, with me, you win. So the question, a question we have to ponder in all of this as we think about this resurrection that invites us to look up, is which voice do you continually want to have in your head? The voice of the grave or the voice of Jesus? Death will defeat you. Worry and stress about today because I'm coming for you. You're going to be alone forever. All that matters is now. Darkness will last forever. Game over, you lose. Do any of us want to go through our lives with this reality? Oh, we can pretend and keep ourselves occupied enough that we don't think about it, but that's the voice we hear. Or do we want the voice of Jesus? Death does not get the final word. I do. Don't worry. I have got you. Follow me and you will never be alone again. Forever matters way more than now. My light overcomes the darkness and with me you win. The resurrection invites us to look up. Come to verse 35 and these guys that Jesus revealed themselves to them, and they were coming back to Jerusalem along right after the women, and they come in and they're telling the disciples, and they say, hey, we were talking to him. And as they were telling this to the disciples, verse 36, Jesus himself was suddenly standing there among them. Peace be with you, he said. But the whole group was startled and frightened, thinking they were seeing a ghost. Why are you frightened? Jesus asked. Why are your hearts filled with doubt? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. You can see that it's really me. Touch me and make sure that I am not a ghost, because ghosts don't have bodies as you see that I do. And as he spoke, he showed them his hands and his feet. Peter, if we follow the story, may have sounded like nonsense, but he went to wondering, and then he took Jesus up at his offer to look, to see, and to touch. You know what? Jesus hasn't rescinded that. As we hear the same story today, and as people will hear it, if Jesus waits 10,000 years from now, the invitation will stand. Look at my hands, look at my feet. You can see it's really me. Touch me and make sure that I am not a ghost. They did that day. The question and the encouragement that we're left with this most amazing of stories is the resurrection is an invitation to look up. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the preservation of the story, and thank you for the reality of its impact in the lives of people for generations. And still, even to this very day, transforming people from the inside out. Because you, Lord Jesus, are a risen Savior. In your name I pray. Amen.
Will you stand with me? Stretch your legs a little bit. Sing this chorus of a song we did earlier.
He lives, all honor and power are His, all glory forever, amen. Jesus, you took all our shame, left it in the grave, now we're forgiven. We forgive the work forever done, only by the blood it is finished, though it is finished. You took all our shame, left it in the grave, now we're forgiven, we're forgiven.
Couple of invitations. On your way out today, there'll be some people standing at the door to hand you one of these. It's an invitation to this next series that we're starting a week from today called Where Worry Goes to Die. Seems to be a big issue these days, worry, doesn't it? Seems like it would benefit all of us to contemplate that just a little bit from God's Word. And you can keep this as a reminder to yourself, or certainly pass that out to somebody else to invite you to come as we investigate this question of worry. Another invitation. In Luke 21, Jesus was prophesying, which simply means he was telling the disciples about the future. This was pretty close to his death and resurrection. And this is what he said. And there will be strange signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. And here on earth, the nations will be in turmoil, perplexed by the roaring seas and strange tides. People will be terrified at what they see coming upon the earth. For the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then everyone will see the Son of Man coming on a cloud with power and great glory. So when all these things begin to happen, stand and look up, for your salvation is near. Let me ask you, is your salvation near this morning? Is that decision to move from this is foolishness to wondering to belief? Myself and Derek and some of the elders will be up front after service. We'd love to talk with you, pray with you about the decisions that God is moving in your heart and any challenges of the day. We'd love to go to the Lord with you on behalf of those that are in your life that you're concerned about. Now, Father, we close our conversation for the day But we do not close, and never will we ever be able to close the implications of what we've talked about today. And I pray that our hearts would be those hearts who are prepared to consider that there is something far bigger than us, and that the God who could create the entire world at a command is certainly one who could raise somebody from the dead. And I just pray, Lord, you would move us forward into the implications in each and every one of our lives. And I ask for your blessing, on each and every person here, that your face would shine upon them. They would know the good and the right and the true and be empowered to enter into that. May your spirit of peace, of power, of courage, of strength, of love, of compassion and kindness be upon each and every person, each and every marriage, each and every family represented. And I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Happy Easter. Have a great week.